This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to have one of those wonderful adventures that we so enjoy, going to strange places and exploring strange things. But this time, it's a strange and wonderful place. And I don't know one of our guests, but the other one I do know is strange and wonderful in his own right, Graham Phillips. He is the author of 20 books concerning historical mysteries. He lives in Birmingham in central England, one of the world's centers of mysteries, central England. Our other guest is new to the show. Jody Russell is a historical researcher and investigator of paranormal phenomena. She lives in Los Angeles. So right now, as we are recording this, Jody is in a heat dome and Graham isn't, and neither am I. So two of us are cool as cucumbers, and the third one, oh dear. Okay, so I'd like to introduce now and bring on my two guests. We're going to be talking, there we are, about their book, Strange Fate, an extraordinary true story of paranormal discovery. And boy, is it ever extraordinary. And it's definitely a true story. So welcome, both of you, to Dreamland. I'm so happy to have you here.
Thank you so much.
Good. We have a lot of fun this morning, and no question about that. All right. Strange Fate. And either one of you can answer these questions. What drew you in the first place to do this? Graham, why don't you start with this? Because I think you were the instigator of the process of the program. Or was it you, Jody? Which one of you sort of came on this whole story first?
I think it was both of us, Graham. But Graham was the one that was more interested in the me and I at the time. Correct, Graham?
Yeah, I've been investigating this strange secret society that existed in the Victorian period that was centered on a big old Victorian mansion called Biddulph Grange, which is not too far from where I live in central England, but it's up in the moorlands and rather windswept hillsides of the northern Midlands of England. And basically, it was a really strange story because what the people who lived there in the mid-19th century said was that, well, to start off with, there was a man called James Bateman, and he owned the house and his family lived there. He was in business with a man called Robert Heath, who lived a couple of miles away. They were both rich industrialists. And James Bateman found on the north part of his land an old tomb that was, you know, a good few thousand years old. And it was a big mound. And he had a cousin called Thomas Bateman. He wanted him to excavate it. And the Bateman family and the Heath family were both there when it was excavated in May of 1851. While they were doing it, Robert Heath's little daughter, Mary, who was only 7 at the time, kind of got away from the crowd of people and clambered into a hole that they'd cut in the side of the mound to get through to the burial chamber and was the first inside. And she came out different. She claimed that when she was in there, she'd seen a strange world with fairy beings and all sorts of things. But what was most remarkable is she came out and suddenly appeared to have psychic abilities that she didn't have before. She started telling people things about themselves that she couldn't have known. But more than this, she also, when she was in the tomb, she dug down a little bit in a place that she knew she had to in her mind somehow, and found a small stone about 2 inches by 2 inches cut into the shape of a heart made of rose quartz. And she said this had been there for years and it was very important. And she eventually proved that she had gained these psychic abilities by taking the families to a nearby ruined chapel, told them to dig in a corner of the church and they would find a long forgotten crypt. and it was there. That's how it started. And I really wanted to investigate how did this happen? And what was it all about?
This was back in the 1850s.
That's right.
Tell us about the place now, Biddulph Grange, because I looked it up on the internet. It looks like an absolutely magnificent and beautiful place. Jody, as the historical researcher, perhaps you can enlighten us a little bit about the Grange itself.
Oh, the Grange is absolutely stunning. And as a gardener and a rancher myself, I know how difficult it is to get to things growing. But this was established by the Bateman family with all of these during the Victorian era. He would travel all over and collect samplings from around the world and created these gardens. And it's just absolutely extraordinary. It's now open to the public, which it only just became so like in the 1980s. Is that right, Graham?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And what they've done is they made all of these mock temples. They have an Egyptian temple. They have a Chinese temple, a Celtic glen. And that's what we discovered. They were doing rituals, which they called fates at the time, these ceremonies there that were part of this Mianaya group,
we'll get the discussion of the group in a little while. Now, what happened to the Grange as the 19th century came to the end?
What happened was that they built all these shrines, and it was Little Mary that had basically first started telling them to do it. A seven-year-old girl, the lady of the Grange, who was named Maria Bateman, whose husband was the owner, she started this group called the Order of Mianaya, a group mainly of women who were interested in the paranormal, the new craze of spiritualism, mysticism, and all this. And she built these temples that Jody had mentioned in the grounds of the Grange, in amongst all these wonderful gardens that her husband had created. And there they were going to carry out these strange meditational exercises, rituals from ancient Egypt and from ancient China and ancient Rome, different cultures, to try and, according to what they wrote, they were trying to change fate, trying to change circumstances in the world for the better. Ultimately, you ask what happened to them at the end of the 19th century. In the late 1890s, the place burnt down, and a lot of it burnt down. Some of it still survived, but all the objects, the ritual accoutrements that they'd gathered from around the world, plus many of their writings, perished in the flames, and the group basically disbanded.
Now, I, of course, have read the book, and I thought that this was an important event because they were trying to basically use what amounts to what we now call white magic to improve the state of the world. And then everything they had built to use to do this is destroyed in a fire, whereupon the 20th century, by far the most awful century in the history of mankind, although I think the 21st is going to be pretty difficult too,
right?
begins, and within a few years, millions upon millions of young men are being fed to machine guns. It's as if the dark side won.
It does certainly seem like that, but what appears to have been their intention wasn't to bring world peace. All the women that were involved in this were members of the original early first wave feminist groups. They were all feminists, famous feminists. Now, when they started this group in the 1850s, the lot of women in the Western world and in Britain, America, and elsewhere was awful. Women didn't have the right to own their own property. They couldn't inherit property. It all went to the husband, guardian, or brother, or father. They couldn't start their own businesses. They had absolutely no rights at all. Husbands were even allowed to beat their wives within reason, supposedly. And this was all over the place in the Western world. Now, yes, they wanted to change things. And during the period that they were operating between then and the 1890s, vast amounts of things changed. Women suddenly got the right to own property here, the States, elsewhere, various places throughout the world. They got the right to inherit. They got the right to start their own businesses, and many did, and many more things like this. So I think when it, and by the end of it, they were getting the vote. Now, this required, women had got no say. They weren't allowed in government in any form at all, or they weren't represented. But what happened was that men suddenly started saying, no, let's start giving women these rights. It took men in parliaments and Congress in the States and throughout
Europe. Yeah, it was quite a fight.
To actually change. Perhaps that's what they managed to achieve. But maybe that, maybe at the end they were trying to go further and change, bring about world peace, and negativity stopped it. It just seems strange that, as you say, after this fire, things started to get very bad for the world.
Yeah, it does seem strange. And Jody, let's talk about a little bit of the history here. Let's go back to Morgana and Morgan Le Fay. First, tell us what place she plays in the story and then who she was.
I think that's Graham's area of expertise because he's the Arthurian expert here.
Okay, well, then I don't want to get ahead of myself. and in order to enable me to collect my thoughts, folks, right, we're going to take a little break. We're going to
He's got the Morgana. Yeah, go ahead, Graham.
Yeah, it will. And when we come back, we're going to learn about some very ancient powers and something that has been lost to the modern world that once was probably among the most valuable of all human knowledge.
Them. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them.
Available as an audiobook on Audible.com, Apple Books, and Amazon. Available as a hardcover and paperback everywhere. Available as a Kindle on Amazon.com. And you can go to UnknownCountry.com and order all of my books. Where are we going? Where have we come from? What secrets have been buried? What secrets have been lost? What is the truth about the close encounter experience? You have never heard any of this before. Them. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi, in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. You were, what happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with in, with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're back. We're talking to Graham Phillips and Jody Russell. I didn't see, and maybe I overlooked it, if there is a website connected with the book. I don't know.
Yes, it is. It's strangefate.net.
Strangefate.net, folks. Okay. Well, you can tell I haven't been to the website because I'm more of a reader than an internet.
Right. We're getting used to the social media part of things as well. We're also on Facebook.
I'll never get used to social media. I find it so difficult. I enjoy my fans a lot and my friends on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, but I find it frightening, the whole thing, because of its ability to make it seem as if what people wish was true was true. And that is the genesis of all of this horrible political mess that we're in. Because politicians have followed the Hitler playbook. Hitler would go to his, and I promise, folks, I'll turn back to the story in a minute. He would go to a speech and he would blare out at the beginning. And if you've listened to Hitler's speeches, as I have, you'll see him doing this first, one issue after another. And the one that got the most response would be the one he then concentrated on in the speech. And he gradually created an atmosphere of nightmarish prejudice in Germany that led to the deaths of millions upon millions of people, including the Jews, of course. Nowadays, they use social media and they watch and see which tweets get the most clicks, which YouTube things on YouTube get the most looks, sites, and so forth. And they concentrate on that without regard to whether or not it's true. And we're being destroyed by this. And I'm speaking out against it now. I'm purposely not speaking about any particular politicians because I'm not political and this isn't a political show. But that is a problem. Okay, I'm off my soapbox now. Now let's talk a little bit. Go back to the beginning again, to James Bateman and the beginning of The Grange. Who was he and how did he come there?
Well, he was a businessman. Well, his father had made a fortune in coal and iron, coal mining and ironworks. He was one of the new rich in the 19th century. And he bought where the Grange was. He bought the property, and all that was there was an old broken down rectory, I think, at the time, but a lot of land. And he built the Grange itself in the 1840s. And what was fascinating is when, after this little episode had happened, when Mary came out psychic and Maria Bateman, his wife, decided to start this group, James Bateman started traveling the world, collecting seeds and saplings and other plants to ship back to England to go into his garden. And Maria was left in charge. She built these shrines, these temples in the garden, these mock Egyptian tombs and so forth. And what happened then was that James Bateman, he was away for most of the time. So it was just up to Maria to get on with what was happening. But what was fascinating is we discovered that each of these temples was built on earlier ancient stone circles and standing stones and mounds that dated from 4, maybe even 5,000 years ago, like this one particular tomb that little Mary had gone into.
Now, let's talk now about Mary Heath. That's the little Mary you're referring to, isn't it? Yes. Tell us about her history and life a little bit. We know what she did when she was seven. And incidentally, does the stone that she found still exist?
Yes, it does. I actually have it. It's right there.
There it is.
You have it.
It's right here. It's in the shape
of a heart. I'm so glad I asked.
Right?
How fascinating.
This is why I wanted to be on the video part, right?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, we had the usual trouble at the beginning of the show, but it's
beautiful that was
now,
me. Oh, sorry about that.
Yeah, it's nothing new.
We went in search of it following a series of clues. After the fire had burnt down the place, they decided to the group should be halted. The lady who was in charge at that point was quite a famous pre-Raphaelite model and painter called Jane Morris, the wife of William Morris, who designed the wallpaper that's still famous today. Jane Morris hid that Heart of the Rose, which is their most prized possession, that somehow was said to have the power to alter fate. And they were channeling the energy from that, supposedly, through these temples and so forth. And she hid this stone and left a whole series of clues, like in paintings, to where it was. Now, I'll probably come back to that later, but you asked about Mary Heath. When she grew up, she took over the Order of Nehemiah. The Bateman family eventually sold the property to the Heath family, and she ended up running the place. By this time, women could run businesses because already things were beginning to change. And around 1870, she ran the Order of Nehemiah when she was in her 20s. But what's fascinating is that as a child, she actually inspired the story of Alice in Wonderland. Remember, she crawled into this little mound and came and said, "Oh, there's all these little creatures in there." Well, she met Lewis Carroll when she was young. When the family went to stay with a family that he was tutoring the children of, and she inspired not only the story of Alice in Wonderland, but also the story of Alice through the Looking Glass. And Jodie and I managed to track down what had happened to that Alice in Wonderland mirror, and when we found it at a place called Hawcross Hall, which is not actually that far from where I live, it's now a hotel and a spa resort. Well, when we got there, people said, Jodie, you explain what happened when we found the mirror.
Oh, it was mind blowing. I mean, and then all of a sudden it was attached to a little girl that was a ghost that was supposedly haunting that mirror. And they even described her as a little Victorian girl that looked like Alice in Wonderland. And we're like, what? Graham?
Yeah, there was one particular case
I'm
where
one guy came.
Right.
One guy we spoke to actually said that he came in there late one night and saw the little girl in the mirror kind of grinning at him like this. And she actually responded to him. Loads of other people claimed to have seen the ghost in the mirror. We thought, well, it can't be Mary Heath, even if she looked like Alice in Wonderland, because the pictures in Lewis Carroll's book, he designed himself and got a proper artist to copy them based on what the little girl who supposedly inspired his stories looked like. So we can assume that Mary Heath is a child, although we have no photographs of her because they all burned in the fire. She may have looked like Alice in Wonderland, dressed in that way. And, put it this way. If she's in the mirror haunting it, well, she didn't die until she was 28 or 29. So why is she haunting a mirror? Well, the only thing we could think is that somehow she was able to duplicate herself in the mirror, like the ancient Tibetans and Japanese Shinto believe that you can create what's called a tulpa, a thought form copy of yourself in a mirror. Of course. So maybe that happened. I remember looking into it once and got inspiration about where we should look next for in our search for that stone.
And you took a picture from that same angle where the little girl was seen in the mirror. And we have an image of it looks like in the corner of a little girl, even wearing the headband of Alice, a little blue bodice looking down. And it looks identical to how it was depicted in his drawings of Lewis Carroll.
It's a photograph of her.
Yeah. Yes.
It's a photograph taken of the mirror.
That you
we didn't
took,
notice
Matt.
Anything at the time, but in the corner was what Jody said, a kind well, of we'll image of what appears show, to be a little girl.
We can show that on
a
the
blue
show.
Headband and a blue bodice and long blonde hair. But
do you have that photo on your website, Graham? Is that on your website?
What?
Is that photo on your website?
I can't remember.
If not, we can post it.
Yeah, good.
Oh, yeah, we should put it on the main site, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's fabulously interesting. You should be more aware of the most interesting things about what you're doing.
Well, so many things happen that it's kind of like...
I know it. It's just... Well, that's why you're here, because I've been trying for 2 days to figure out how to do this interview without completely... It's like a tidal wave almost of stuff.
Yeah.
It's absolutely amazing. It's a massive incursion of a paranormal energy into the human world. And, you know, I thought to myself when Mary first went down into that tomb, I thought of some rather disconnected things in my own life. As I discussed in one of my books, I believe A New World, I spent a good bit of time experiencing a parallel universe, and and in England they're the two children of Wolf Pit who came out of another world. One of them, the little boy, died, and the little girl lived on. This is in the 14th century. Lived on for years, and so there is some other world, and maybe more than one other world, folded up in this whole reality that we live in.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, and it seems to me that Mary entered it, and I know from personal experience that can be extremely dangerous, because they attacked me after I did this, and I lost about a third of the sight in my right eye as a result of this attack.
Oh my.
So, you know, it's a serious business, and it's entirely real. We live in this lunatic world where reality is we are in denial about reality. We it's called the secular world, and it came about after the Enlightenment. And we have decided to believe only in the parts of reality that we can control.
And what we can see.
And see. But the truth is, this is only a little corner. And you guys, went into the bigger world for a while in this journey of yours.
We did. It's
fabulously interesting.
And it was very confusing to live it because it didn't go in any chronological order either. And we did keep splitting off and things kept changing. When we first started talking and researching Mary Heath, she lived to be 80. And then all of a sudden we're in a reality where she died at 28. And we're like, well, if it keeps jumping, and everything was still changing and facts were changing and times were changing and situations up until the time we finished the book even. And we're like, how are we going to even bring this book out if it keeps changing?
You know? Okay, someone, you take your choice as to who wants to start, has got to unpack this apparent journey along different timelines as you were writing the book, a book which was written on the borderland between realities, in my opinion. But indeed, before we do that, we're going to take one of those marvelous little breaks that our subscribers, after all, don't have to endure. But don't endure it. Instead, why don't you get a copy of Them or Communion or one of my other books? And because this show doesn't really have outside advertising, we just advertise Unknown Country and its offerings. And even better, subscribe to the site. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it. And I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
Okay, we're back, and we're with Graham Phillips and Jody Russell. They're both, surprisingly enough, still here. They haven't disappeared into a parallel universe yet.
Let's hope not.
Well, on their way. Jody especially has the heart of the rose. I don't want to digress now. Let's go back to the changing facts of the story and what that was like to experience. And how did it actually, like you said, Mary was 80 at one point and then died at 28 in another. Tell us about that.
Yeah, Graham.
Well, I kind of best tell it how it started. We knew about this stone that Jody just showed called the Heart of the Rose. We knew it was supposed to, that's what Mary found in the tomb. It was supposed to have miraculous powers. We decided let's go in search of this because we knew there was clues. To begin this search, we start at the beginning. We went to the tomb that Mary had gone to and found this a couple of miles north of Biddulph Grange, which is now not a mound anymore, but just the inside sort of stone chamber. we went there, and it was a beautiful sunny day, and the two of us were there, and the moment we arrived, well, very shortly after, this cloud kind of came over us, and it was literally just over us, really, in the immediate countryside, and it started pouring. There was a complete downpour. There was thunder, lightning, wind was blowing. I was filming all this at the time because I was just filming the tomb. But the countryside around, it was still sunshining and completely normal. There was even cows still standing up, and they normally lie down or whatever you call it on the ground when there's rain. But there was no rain within a quarter of a mile of where we were. And this went on for about 5 minutes and then just abruptly stopped. Later, when we looked at the video, there's a ball of light that seems to shoot from the tomb and across the road opposite. We had it examined by experts, and they said, oh, it might be something wrong with the camera. Perhaps it's ball lightning. Whatever it was, for all this to happen, just as we were there, we thought, that's just weird. When we got back to Biddulph Grange, that's when we noticed the first change of universes, whatever you want to call it, the change of reality. We knew that the fire at Biddulph Grange had happened in 1897. Suddenly, we were talking about it, and everyone said, no, it happened in 1896. And we knew it had happened in 1897. We'd been researching it for some time. That was the first thing we realized had changed. Jodie then mentioned about Mary Heath. We knew that she lived until she actually eventually, in the research that we've been doing over the years, we knew that after the fire, which we thought was 1897, she moved to America, to California, to Oxnard. And we would have been doing a lot of research there with other people to try and find out, you know, where she'd ended up living. But now suddenly they said, no, Mary Heath died in 1872. We went to the church to try and find her tomb. It wasn't there. But a couple of about last year, about in the summer of last year, no, it wasn't autumn of last year, we went to that church and there was a great big tomb there for Mary Heath that had never been there before. Oh, I know lots of people who had been there still who had said, no, there was nothing like that there.
Oh,
but Jody, I mean, when we were in the church, weird stuff happened.
Well, oh, no, it was massive. And every time we went to the church, you know, it would be closed. And then when this time we were going, oh, it's open. So we walked in. Nobody was around. And we lo and behold, this massive tomb with this angel with massive wings is in the corner, dedicated to Mary Heath. And we're like, how can we ever miss that? And then the door kept closing and opening, and the lights kept flicking on and off. It was just really quite the experience. And a lot of people say, we've been to that church many times, many years, and never have found Mary Heath's grave ever. We just assumed that because she died in London, that she was buried down there.
So other people have been in the church and not seen the tomb as well.
Yeah, Graham himself had been in there before. Yeah.
And many other people that we know.
Is the tomb there now? If you went there now, would you see it? Or do you know?
Yes, it's there now, yeah. Well,
if it was just us.
We're in this right universe.
Well, I'm going to be in England in October. I'm going to go and see if I see the tomb.
Yes. You should get together with Graham and he'll take you to all the places. They're all within a matter of miles.
There was other complete places that appeared from nowhere. I mean, what about, because we were interested in the Alice in Wonderland story, we looked to see if there was an Alice in Wonderland museum or anything like that anywhere in the country, and there wasn't one. There was nothing to do with it, really, a few little things. But when we went to a town called Telford, we were driving around looking for somebody we were going to go and interview, and then suddenly this sign appeared in front of us that wasn't there the last time we went down this street, saying, The Alice in Wonderland experience. There's a great big Disney-like theme park tour of all the different things to do with the, you know, there's rides to do with Alice's adventures and all that. But that wasn't there before.
And it was supposedly there, had been there for years. And no one's going, we've never heard of it.
And what about that cafe that appeared from nowhere?
Right. That was the same day. We went to Stafford. And then all of a sudden, Graham would just say, well, okay, it would be great if we have another coincidence. And he snapped his fingers. Got to be careful of snapping your fingers, Graham. And all of a sudden we turn the corner and there's a cafe called the Mad Hatter's Cafe. And it was
like, that before.
And that had never been there. And it's not there now.
Oh, it's not there now.
Do you have any idea what you're doing in the other universe at the present time?
I hope they're
not describing the tomb or the theme park or the Mad Hatter's Cafe or anything.
They must have written a different book.
Right, exactly. And I will have not asked about them because I read a different version of the book. Right. I think that's quite possible. I think it's, you know, this is the thing that people want the world that they live in to be something that they understand. And I don't blame them. I feel the same way. We all do. But the truth is, we don't understand it.
No, not
and either. Above all, we don't understand this very new thing between our ears. It's only a couple of 100,000 years old, the brain, the human brain. It contains half as many neurons in one brain as there are stars in this whole universe. A trillion neurons, 2 trillion stars. This brain is really big.
And they say we're only using 10% of it, really.
Oh, no, that's not true. That's a folk tale.
Oh, really?
We actually, oh, yeah. I study modern neurology very extensively, and we do use our brain very, very. It's a very interesting process, what goes on in the brain, but it's far more than 10%. We haven't abandoned most of our brain at all.
Oh, good. That's great news.
Yeah. Yeah, I know it's extremely complex.
But then the consciousness is a whole different concept, right?
That's an interesting thing because the brain appears to be an interface between the physical world and another world. That is to say, consciousness. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so many people don't want that to be true. But the more neurology, the deeper we go into neurology, the more mysterious consciousness becomes. And right at the present time, even some very materialistic neurologists are beginning to agree that we have not understood and don't have really any clue as to a physical seat of consciousness, and probably because there isn't one. We're plugged into something, only your plugs are loose, you guys.
I kind of like them that way.
So how did you feel when you began to, let me go back. Did these timeline shifts start before or after you found the Heart of Rose?
Oh, way before.
They stopped after we found it.
Stopped after you found
it. Yeah.
How did we
make that? Was on the 13th of October last year we found that, and it hasn't happened since.
Where did you find it precisely?
Well, there were these paintings that were left behind by the group. And we managed to solve the clues. I won't bother going into all that. But
also Mary's tomb was one of the clues too, Graham.
Right? Oh, yeah. That would tell you one of the clues was Mary's tomb. It had these two big angels on it. And there were two big rocks nearby known as the angels, big sort of towering rock formations.
With a dove.
And there was a dove above these angels. And it's called the Dovedale is the name, you know, a few miles from Bidoff, where these angel rocks were. And it was down there that there was a cave. One of the paintings showed this very cave. And when we were going there, I mean, well, you tell them what happened when we were going there.
Oh, well, we knew that we wanted to get to a pub because we lost Wi-Fi service. And we knew that there was a pub called the Mermaid Pub. And so we were driving there, we went through this really thick fog where we could hardly see and we couldn't find the turnoff. And when we got there, it wasn't called the Mermaid Pub anymore. And we're like, well, we just checked this like 15 minutes ago online. It was there. And they're going, it's never been the Mermaid Pub. It's been this forever and stuff. And then we're going, oh, we'll stop and we'll get some lunch and we'll kind of figure out what we're going to do. And all of a sudden they're going, well, are you going to put your order in now? Because the kitchen's closing. We're like, and we looked at our clock. We lost 3 hours going through this fog that only was maybe 10 minutes at the most.
Couldn't have been more.
Couldn't even been more than that. So all of a sudden we had a time slip.
Yeah, well, you had more than a time slip. You went between universes in that fog.
Well, this pub is now called something completely different, the Old Oak. But it was then that we got to where this cave was.
Yeah.
And when we got there, I mean, it got even weirder.
You went from one universe to another.
It was almost like we had to be in between two universes for all of these circumstances to line up. And we would just bounce from one to the other.
Make you think what we have lost. The knowledge, the lost knowledge, because here we are, three people talking about this extraordinary experience of slipping between realities, being taken between realities. And most people just don't believe this is even possible now.
I think it happens to us all the time if we're really aware of it. Just on little simple things like, well, I know I put my keys there. Now my keys aren't there. You know, for instance, I think it happens just minutely. But I think if we really open up and read the landscape, as we call it, I think it's happening. And, you know, and I think it guides us in interesting ways if we allow it to.
Well, you know, I'll give you an example of it happening in my life this morning. And I'm sure everyone listening has these experiences all the time. It's nothing special. I swim in the mornings early. It's 6:30 sometimes. And to swim, you have to make a reservation at the pool. And you require showing a card as you go in. And I've had trouble with the card. The card keeps disappearing. And I went a few days ago and the card wasn't in my swim bag. So I got in without it and I got a new card. Put the card and the new card in the swim bag. Then when I opened the swim bag to go swimming the next 2 days later, I had two cards in the swim bag.
I
got two cards in the swim bag. I can't go wrong. Today, when I went to swim, there's only one card in the swim bag now.
See?
I haven't, you know, this is, and I'm saying this little humble thing. And Anne, back in the old days on Unknown Country, she's got a great diary entry called Dryer Sheets about disappearing and reappearing dryer sheets. And this is an ordinary part of life that we deny is ordinary. So what are we? Are we slipping between timelines and between this, or between universes entirely? In your cases, it seems much more dramatic. I mean, the place is called the Mermaid in one universe and what, the Old Oak in another?
The Old Oak?
In another. I mean, that's not just like a disappearing or reappearing swim card. That's major.
Well, and it was interesting. Go ahead, Ryan.
No, yeah, go.
Go ahead, Graham.
I was going to say there's a place that we went to. We didn't even put this in the book because there was loads of things that happened where we couldn't put in the book because it just didn't fit the actual main story of searching for this stone. But there's a place called Abbots Bromley, which isn't too far from Birmingham in central England, which we went to because it was connected with the whole Heath family. We went there. Anyway, every year on May Day, they have Morris dancers, you know, the traditional English dancers that wave around and things and bells on them and stuff. And they have lots of them. And we went there once and they made Jodie the May Queen. They picked her up and they, you know, took her around the place and she was a guest of honor.
And it was
a lot. Back the following year. Now, this is the period when we're doing all this kind of research. Went back the following year and there was no Morris men dancing around. They have Morris.
We never have Morris men here. It's like,
and they said, we went to this pub where the Morris men always go and drink. And they said, no, we don't have Morris dancers here. Never have had. We thought they were having us on, but nobody turned up. Nobody in the village knew about it. The following year, we went back again and there was hundreds of Morris people. We've always had them. And then the year after that, this was like how long it's taken us to do all this research, really. The year after that, there weren't any, and we showed photographs of us dancing with Morris people, and Jody being carried around by them to the people of the village, and they said, "Oh, that's spooky. Oh, don't want to talk about that." Ooh.
And that's the same town with the Alice Gate, where the girl is supposed to disappear. God, yeah,
Tell me about the Alice Gate. Folks, I hope you're having as much fun as I am. I'm just rolling with this at this point. What is the Morris, the gate, that you, Alice Gate?
Graham?
God, you tell them, Jody.
No, you go ahead.
No, go on. You tell them.
Don't argue. Jody, you're elected. You tell us.
Well, there's supposedly this gate in the Victorian era again, where these young girls would go through and just disappear and never come back, right? And it's literally right by in the churchyard where all these Morris dancers are supposed to be about. So it seems like this. It's almost like this town is like a bit of a porthole. There's like a wormhole where different things happen. And
what is this town called again?
Abbots Bromley.
One time when we went to this gate where these girls in Victorian hunts are supposed to disappear, we were there and this family, this little girl came running down the path and her mother was saying to her, Alice. And we thought, that's weird. I mean, she was a little girl, but in modern clothes. She wasn't obviously Alice in Wonderland, but she did look like her with the long blonde hair. And then there was the mother and a couple of boys, I think, came behind.
Those two boys, yeah.
And we started saying something to them. They just completely looked through us if we didn't
exist. We didn't even exist. None of us knew that we were there.
And then they started to they got down on a grave and started to have a picnic on a grave, which is the sort of thing they used to do in Victorian times. They'd have a picnic on the grave of their great grandparents or whatever. And we went up to them and said, is this usual? They totally ignored them. They weren't being funny and ignoring us. They couldn't see us. And then we just watched literally over them like this. And without them taking any notice, they were chatting away about things and happy, dancing around and whatever. And then they left. I was going to get out and sort of touch the lady on the head to see if she actually felt it. But thought if she did, I'd probably be arrested.
Freak her out a little bit much. There'd be a hand coming from nowhere. So, yes, other universes.
Yeah, so anyway, you did ask about what happened when we found the stone. Well, after we'd gone through this mist and time had been lost and this pub had changed its name, we got to this cave where the stone was supposedly hidden if we'd have got all the clues solved, right? And it was like a cavern inside it, but there was a great big hole in the roof where the cave roof must have collapsed years ago. And outside were all these trees and bushes and stuff above us, about 20 feet above us. So it was a great big hole, about 20 or 30 feet across, about 20 feet high cave walls. And we thought that the only place that a stone like that could be hidden in the cave was in one of these crevices that was kind of up higher up in the walls. There was like a kind of recess, a natural recess in the wall itself, about, you know, 4 or 5 feet wide and maybe 3 feet deep. And there was all these cracks further up. We thought somebody could have wedged it in there, but how are we going to get it? At that moment, we then get a storm again. It had started with a storm. It ended with a storm. Suddenly, out of nowhere, this storm took place, thunder, lightning, and the rain started pouring down so badly that within a few minutes, it was cascading down the walls. And at one point, there was like this flash of lightning, and it really looked like, they probably made up of shadows from the trees outside, it really looked like there was a figure like with raised wings like an angel shadow standing against the other wall. And at that moment, there was a massive crash of thunder and the rain stopped. Within a few minutes, it was dry. The sun was back out. And when we looked on the floor at the bottom of this crevice where this like angel figure had been, we saw on the floor there was the stone that Jody's got there. Yeah. And it was just literally lying on the floor. I mean, it must have been washed down from these crevices by the rain that just so happened to have happened then. What was amazing also is we realized that it was the 13th of October. It was exactly 150 years since the death of Mary Heath, if that meant something, to the dead.
The other Mary Heath.
The second of the men, see how confusing it can get. The other one, I don't know where the other one died. The other one's still in Oxnard.
Have you gone to Oxnard, Jody, perhaps to find her? See if you could
find
her.
We did years ago, and we couldn't. It was a dead end. So, yeah, we did that.
So you're not in this universe. It's a dead end. Mm-hmm. I wonder if I went, what would happen?
Right?
Because maybe we're bridging between the universes right now without knowing it.
We could be. We could be.
When you play this tape back.
Sorry, they were mean as hell. I learned how to move physically between the universes. Oh. And boy, that was not wanted. And I think it's because it's an imbalance that my theory, I mean, I have no idea. Sometimes I think the people on the other side find me extremely annoying. And in any case, I think it's because there's probably already a Whitley in the universe I went to. And two of them won't do. And they basically just got rid of me.
That would make sense.
The thing about us is there was none versions of us where we ended up. But presumably, maybe if we changed brains, at least we had the same clothes on.
You know, it's very interesting the way these storms and fogs and things seem to precede the movement, your movement from one reality to another. I wonder, I think I'm going to not take another break. This is just too much fun. I don't want to, if you want to drink a glass of water or something, Graham, go ahead. I noticed you drank one earlier.
It's almost like there has to be like a shift in the frequency, like nature kind of changes it.
Yeah.
To awaken or to open. I mean, it gets even weirder because we would have situations almost like there's a patchwork universe where, like with the date of the fire being from 97 to 96, some people remember it as 96 and some people remember it as 97. So that's almost like it merged and it kind of patched itself on.
You know, here's something quite weird that somehow in some weird way fits that. I'm often in a very unstable state. And I think any time you start to move between universes, it stays like that. You become an unstable presence. So I was driving up to the grocery store and I noticed that a street that is always 26th Street, which I cross on the way up to the grocery store. And understand, I've lived here for a long time, nearly 20 years. There are no secrets on the street I'm talking about to me. And suddenly the sign said 27th Street. And I thought, what? It can't be true. It's not 27th, it's 26th.
Right.
Then I looked again and it was 26th again. What is this number 7? I noticed that it figures in your experiences too. It is the number of completion. It's a complete octave.
7 features in our thing, does it?
Yeah. Well, you mentioned, how did you mention the number 7?
It was 1897.
Yeah, 1897 and 1896 with a fire.
1896 and 26th Street and 27th.
Right, and the 7, yeah.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
See what I'm saying? There's some kind of, in other words, there's something here that we don't understand.
It could really send somebody crazy. That's the thing. And I think a lot of people might think they're crazy, but it's actually happening for real.
Well, exactly. Of course. Yeah. Well, you go to a traditional Morris dance that's been happening for years, one year, and you go back the next year, nobody's ever heard of it. That would make you feel fairly crazy.
Right. They thought we were really crazy.
Some people believe that crop circles, I've never investigated them, so I don't know if they're real or not, but some people say, well, crop circles are a way some kind of alien beings are trying to communicate with us. Maybe what we're talking about here is some kind of communication which is so far beyond us, it ends up as changing of reality. I mean, that sounds
maybe
nuts.
So.
I mean, and I certainly know that after we were doing this, I started to get dreams. I mean, Jody has visions when she does meditation that could help us along sometimes. And I didn't put this in the book, but I started to get like a lady in Victorian clothes appearing at the end of my bed in lucid dreams, and very lucid. I could even talk to her, but she'd normally kind of just look back at me. And I thought she might have been Laura Heath. That was Mary Heath's sister-in-law. And I said once to her, I said, "You seem to be real, but it's not really Laura Heath, is it?" And she put into my mind, I said, "Why anything?" She said, "I'm just a construct." So I thought, oh, that'll do. I mean, in other words, whatever she really looked like, God knows. Perhaps my brain couldn't. Perhaps she has no physical form. I don't know. So I don't know what's behind this, but there's certainly something seemed to be guiding us. But unlike what had happened to you, we never got anything horrible happen to us. Nothing hurt us in any way.
Well, we did have the situations where there was this roundabout that every time we'd go around it, there would be these huge buses or cars that would all of a sudden appear and nearly hit us. So we ended up calling it, instead of the Bermuda Triangle, it was our Bermuda Roundabout. Because, and we're like, okay, Graham, be careful. Because and they would come from nowhere.
We'd suddenly find ourselves in a universe where they drove on the other side of the road or something.
Yeah.
And then it switched back.
So it can be dangerous, you know, because you're losing,
But we were probably saved. But I mean, that time we almost crashed into that bus. I mean, perhaps we had something looking after us rather than putting us in danger.
Right. Right.
I hope. We're not dead.
Well, yeah. But what happened in my case was I went into this other universe physically twice. Okay. I didn't do it on purpose. It just happened. And then when I started trying to go in again, they came out after me.
Basically. So how did you figure out?
Oh, they came across to here.
What?
They came.
Well, what happened? Oh, into this world. Well, I think my listeners know this story. I'm not sure, but I'll tell it again over just a couple of minutes. I was in bed one morning. I was just about to get up, and I started to sit up, and I was suddenly, instead of being in bed, it was about 6 o'clock in the morning, 6:30. Must have been in the summertime because it was already light. I was riding a bicycle down the street, down Montana Avenue, just with there was no change whatsoever. One second I was in the bed and the other second I was riding a bike. And it wasn't my bike, but I was very familiar with it at the same time. I knew it had a different shifting system, and it was a nicer bike, a cooler bike than mine. And as I rode along, I saw that the street lights functioned differently. In other words, at the end of the street of Montana Avenue, which this happened on, there's a street called Ocean Avenue, then a bluff, and then the Pacific Ocean.
I know exactly place. That road, yeah.
Yeah, you know, probably know it well. And I'm riding along, and instead of the red, yellow, green street light, there are two arrows facing in each direction, because this Montana tees into Ocean. And if your arrow was green, that meant you could turn that way. And if it was red, you couldn't. Mm. And it was a different way of doing street lights. It's just as good, and it's just different. And so I was so astonished by this, I reached into my pocket. Notice I already knew I had a cell phone. And I called a friend in Texas, an old friend, to tell him that I was actually in a parallel universe. And I described the streetlights to him, and he says to me, "Well, you're not telling me anything I don't know." And I thought, of course I'm not. I'm calling him in the parallel universe.
That's the universe he was in.
He lived in it too.
He's like, "What do you mean? That's where I live.
And I said, "Well, I guess not." And at that moment, I was back in my room.
Wow.
The next time happened about 10 minutes later. I was starting to get up. I was trying to process this. And suddenly I was driving a car, and it was my car, but it had a different interior. It was a Prius like I had at the time, and a different interior. And I thought, oh boy, now I've got this. I'm in a car. I knew I was not in this universe by this time. I'm slow, but not that slow. Mm. And so I'm driving along, and I'm thinking, where am I going to go? I'm going to go up the Pacific Coast Highway in this other world. I'm going to look all around. I've got a car.
Right.
So I turn onto Ocean, and I'm immediately stopped by a policeman who takes me off into a side, little side kind of cul-de-sac that is not in this world. It's a different, we don't have that cul-de-sac at that place in this world. And he has a clipboard with him. He's dressed in blue, dark blue clothes with a dark blue baseball cap on. And I perceive him as being a policeman. Only he has a very strange pointed face. He doesn't look quite human, but close. And he has a clipboard and he says, "We need to be sure that you know the rules of the road here."
Oh, wow.
And I said, "Oh, I'm sure I do, because I've been driving a long time." He hands me the clipboard and he says, "Well, fine, fill out this form or answer these questions." And he hands me the clipboard. I look at it. It's not in English, Chinese, Greek, any known language. It's a very complex series of hieroglyphs. I've seen them before with the visitors, but I can't read them. So I can't answer the questions.
Right.
And I say, "I'm sorry, I can't read this." And instantly I'm back in my apartment.
Wow, that's fascinating. Wow. That's almost like
so
that.
You're talking to the converted here.
Right.
I believe you guys are definitely loosey-goosey in between the universes, and it happened because of this effort that you made. And now we're going to go into the third section of the show in a moment, and I want to talk now and get into Arthur and Morgan Le Fay and what was happening so very long ago in 500 AD, and why the powers that existed then are still echoing and resonating in the world in such a way that two people who certainly don't expect to find that the mermaid no longer exists end up in the old oak. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us. And we'll see you as always next week. I love you so, and I'm so grateful. Tell your friends about this show. There's nothing like it in the world. This is a unique show, and it's so much fun. So we'll see you next week. Subscribers will keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.